Then in verse 4 it says, we went ashore, found the local believers, and stayed with them a week. So here we have this idea that no matter where we go, it's not like they said that the local believers stayed with them or they found them. They didn't have to go looking for them. They didn't have to go out and, you know, knock on doors and try to find them or anything. You know, they were already there. And so as we go about our daily work or traveling and sharing the gospel or wanting to share the gospel, there are always going to be believers there. And we should always seek them out and then be in fellowship with them. Of course, there's a scripture that says, never forsake the fellowship of other believers. And so there will always be a blessing to us. So there's a point there. And so these believers prophesied through the Holy Spirit that Paul should not go on to Jerusalem. And when we return to the ship at the end of the week, the entire congregation, including women and children, left the city and came down to the shore with us. There we knelt, prayed, and said our farewells. Then we went aboard, and they returned home. And the next stop after leaving Tyre was Ptolemais, where we greeted the brothers and sisters and stayed for one day. And then the next day we went on to Caesarea and stayed at home at the home of Philip, the evangelist, one of the seven men who had been chosen to distribute food. We'll talk about him a little bit later. He had four unmarried daughters and had the gift of prophecy. Several days later, a man named Agabus, who had also the gift of prophecy, arrived from Judea. Verse 11, he came over, took Paul's belt, and bound his own feet and hands with it. Then he said, the Holy Spirit declares, so shall the owner of this belt be bound by the Jewish leaders in Jerusalem and turned over to the Gentiles. And when we heard this, we and the local believers all begged Paul not to go on to Jerusalem. And in verse 13, but he said, why all this weeping? You are breaking my heart. I am not only to be jailed at Jerusalem, but even to die for the sake of the Lord Jesus. And when it was clear that we couldn't persuade him, we gave up and said, the Lord's will be done. And in verse 15, after this, we packed our things and left for Jerusalem. Some believers from the Caesarea area, accompanied us, and they took us to the home of Manasseh, a man originally from Cyprus and one of the early believers. When we arrived, the brothers and sisters in Jerusalem welcomed us warmly. So that's what we're going to be covering tonight. And so in what we just read, what we have here, we have some areas that we refer to here as commitment, honor, courage, good example, or service, and duty. Some of those sound like military acronyms, and a lot of them are. In that, because in what we are doing nowadays, or what we are doing as believers of Christ, there has to be a commitment. There has to be a very strong commitment in what we are doing, not only in just being at church every Tuesday or every Thursday, but it has to be a commitment in our lives. It has to be very important. It has to be very important to us personally. Not that it has to be something important to our friends or anything like that, but it has to actually mean something to us as individuals. And with that commitment always comes an honor. There's a scripture that talks about men of honor, and then you walking into a room, the Holy Spirit will already go before you, and then that the room or the people there will already honor you. They'll honor the Holy Spirit, not honor you as a man, but they will honor the Holy Spirit that brings that light into the room. And there also has to be some courage. We're going to read about Paul, who's going to demonstrate this awesome courage in spite of being talked or being trying to be persuaded into not going forth with the gospel and trying to ask him to back down or test his will for sharing the gospel. And then we'll see in Paul's service how he decided already a long time ago that this is what he had already decided to do. I think from the pulpit, they say a lot, you know, it's not in that moment that you decide what you're going to do. You have to make that decision long before that moment arrives. And so therefore, you're able to just move forward without any hesitation in doing that. And of course, our duty, as we read earlier, is to protect the flock, your family. And in this and in this idea of commitment, honor, courage, example of service, it is our duty to protect the folks that God has placed under us, okay? So we find that we're looking at Hebrews is one of these things. Paul is saying, first thing we want to look at is here is that don't get pulled away by any strange doctrine, right? So always stick to Scripture. And there's a commitment in sharing the gospel of the Bible. And, of course, he talks about this in Ephesians as well. So honor God always. Hebrews 13, verses 15 through 17, it says, therefore, let us offer through Jesus a continual sacrifice of praise to God, proclaiming our allegiance to his name. And don't forget to do good and to share it with those in need. These are the sacrifice that pleases God. So we have in Hebrews, like I was saying earlier, I was trying to just get some idea. And of course, I'll listen to, I don't know if you guys know Carl, the guy that's in the wheelchair. Him and I used to be really close. We was in Greensboro together. And he made a jump drive, actually this jump drive for me. And it had CDs from Joe Fost. Yeah. And so Hebrews, a book of James, and a book of Revelation was on this, jump drive. And I was happening to be going through that today as I was preparing to present this lesson. And I was going through Hebrews 13. I personally like the book of Hebrews. And so this scripture jumped out at me during that. So therefore, let us offer through Jesus a continual sacrifice of praise to God, proclaiming our allegiance to his name. We see that in Paul. Offering a continual praise to God in all that he's doing all the time. You know, we'll get to it later. In Acts 9, we remember that God had already told Paul what was going to happen, no matter what. And so Paul was just continually giving God praise no matter where he is. And that's sort of like what we should be doing. You know, it's going to be tough. Following God the way is tough. It's a tough thing. But nothing compares to what these young men or these men went through in sharing the gospel. It's not even nowhere even close. But they went on about it anyway. And don't forget to do good and to share with those in need. And that's one of the key things here at the Bridge. We try to instill that in everyone, you know, no matter what your background is or where you come from or what you've done. You know, if there is a need to be met, we're always going to try to meet that need as long as the Holy Spirit is leading us to meet that need. We have benevolence and things of that nature. Of course, you know, we do screenings and things like that. But then sometimes, you know, I've been here and done benevolence, man, and, you know, it's just been a Holy Spirit thing. You know, leadership just says, just go ahead and do it. You know, we'll get the paperwork later. You know, this person's really in need. So, you know, it happens that way. And because why? Because these are the sacrifices that pleases God. You know, that's the mission of the Bridge, to reach and teach. You know, I was reading some reviews. I went to our website last night, and somebody said, this is a cult, you know, and it's a whole lot of other things, right? But if you looked at the answers that they replied back to, it was always grace and mercy. You know, and so, and even though the person was saying that it was a cult, you know, the response was, well, this is how you know it's not a cult, you know, it was like a whole paragraph, so you can kind of distinguish. So, you know, I would think that a lot of people would try to dodge that question, but no, you know, we take on the question and try to, you know, help that person grow in that area, because that's pleasing to God. You don't want to try to cut anybody down. You want to just try to move them along and hope you find a good place for your ministry or where you want to go to church. You know, this may not be the place for you. There's a lot of time responses on there, so this is a good thing. And then Hebrews 13, 7 through 8 tells us, your strength comes from God. It's God's grace, not from rules about food, which don't help those who follow them. So again, here we get it into the law, you know, and some of us like to think that by the food we eat, you know, it brings us closer to God. We see that in Romans, Paul says, nope, that's not it. The food and everything you eat or drink doesn't bring you closer to God, you know. Sure, you can take care of your body, but it doesn't have any impact on your relationship with the Lord. You know, either you accept him as your Lord and Savior, or you don't. See? So you can eat pork, you can eat fried chicken, you know, if you like that sort of thing. I happen to like those sorts of things. I had a fried chicken sandwich before I came over here. And so then in Acts 21 and 4, we see this commitment. So what was Paul to do at this point? So in 21 and 4, it says, we went ashore, found the local believers, and stayed with them. And these believers prophesied through the Holy Spirit that Paul should not go on to Jerusalem. Again, we see the Holy Spirit is showing up in these people's lives. Okay, these are other believers. And so we have to be careful even with other believers, right? Everybody agree? Because even other believers can tell you, hey, you know, I got a word from the Lord. You know, this is what God is telling me you should do. You know, you say, well, hold up. God didn't tell me that, right? So, you know, you have to be careful with that. So what we see here is that through the Holy Spirit, right, these men are obviously concerned about Paul's well-being. I mean, I don't think they were trying to unpersuade him in a way that would prohibit him from sharing the gospel. I think they were trying to save him from the torture that he was getting ready to go through. And so Paul, of course, says, I'm going, right? And so if you keep reading, it says, so when we returned, they kept on going. As we went go down in the chapter, he kept going, verse 13. So again, the point being, you know, when someone comes to you and asks you or tells you something to persuade you away from what God has already told you, be careful. You know, just be very careful, you know, because he's not going to speak to me to speak. I mean, he may prophesy. But if God hasn't told you that, you know, then be very careful. So, but then Acts 9 and 15 says, but the Lord said, I'm getting ahead of myself now. All right, so, getting ahead of myself. Let me back up. So, let's see. Getting ahead of myself. So, that was Paul's commitment. All right, and so, that was my train of thought. Let's see. Out of order. Maybe out of order. So in Acts 9 and 15, right, the Lord said to Ananias, he was going down to Paul, that he says, go, for Saul is my chosen instrument to take my message to the Gentiles. This is God's message to Ananias, that he had already chosen Paul. I guess as I mentioned earlier, that Paul already had an instruction of what was going to happen. So this is Acts 9 and 15. As well as to the people of Israel, and I will show him how much he must suffer for my name's sake. So yeah, I'm back on track. So Paul already knew what was going to happen to him in spite of what anybody else would come back and say. So he already had made up his mind as to what he was going to do. All right, so as what we were talking about earlier in verse 8, 21 and 8, it says, the next day he went on to Caesarea and stayed at the home of Philip, the evangelist. Remember, this is the Philip that was with Paul back in Acts 8, in verses 4 through 8. And Philip was one of the chosen seven. So if you want to go back and review that. But then as they began to stone Paul, or not stone Paul, but to stone Stephen after his sharing of the gospel, right, to those men of Jerusalem, Paul, or Saul, was in charge of that stoning. And so you see there that they laid at the feet of Saul their coats, and then they began to murder Stephen. So here is Paul meeting Philip once again, but this time they're on the same side. as before they were on the opposite sides. And I believe this was like 25 years later. What we see here about Philip, it says Philip is the evangelist, one of the chosen men who had been chosen to distribute food. He had four unmarried daughters who had the gift of prophecy. So no doubt God is definitely using Philip and his family. And his family, his four daughters are prophesying. We spoke about that earlier, about prophesying. Of course, you know, that could be foretelling, or that could just be speaking into someone's life, being having an encouraging word. So you have to be careful with those two. Somebody can come to you again and want to prophesy about your future, right? And you have to kind of say, well, you know, God didn't tell me that, you know, and so let me go home and pray about what you're saying, but I haven't heard that from the Lord as of right now. All right. So it brings me to a couple of questions here. So, number one, are you being led by the Holy Spirit when you are making tough decisions? Are you being led by the Holy Spirit when you are making tough decisions? Are you praying about it continually? These are some very important aspects of walking with the Lord. Being led by the Holy Spirit, praying about it continually, and are you listening intently? Are you listening to hear from the Lord? I mean, I think every time I come in here, every step I take, I'm trying to listen. I want to hear something, because I don't want to do something wrong. You know, not that I'm walking on eggshells or anything, but you want to, you know, present a character that's becoming of the person that you are. You know, if I want to be recognized as a leader, then everything that I do and say must be of a leader. Yeah, you know, I missed the mark. Don't get me wrong now. I missed the mark quite a bit. But at least I'm praying about it, and I'm continually thinking about it, being better, and I'm intently listening. Now, I think I mentioned the last time, or I mentioned to someone here, man, you know, I was thinking about this earlier today, too, you know. I had a couple of guys on my mind about good leaders in this church, you know, and I can name a few. But when I stopped and really thought about it, man, I thought, man, you know, all of the elders here, not including me, all of the elders here have been influential in my life since I've been here. They have been. I remember when I first came, Cecil was sitting there. When I first came to the Calvary Chapel, I went to a men's breakfast, and we in a little kitchen, right? And the first person that I heard teach was Cecil. Blew me away. I was like, I didn't think that guy even knew the Bible. Blew me away. He doesn't say a lot, but I never forget that. Every time I see you, I remember that day. I said, my God, I said, that dude knows the word, man. He spread, and it touched me. So, you know, a lot of these guys here, man, are good leaders, man. And I mean that, and I mean it from the bottom of my heart. I learned how to be a good leader at the Bridge. I served 23 years in the Navy. I have never learned leadership in the Navy like I learned at the Bridge. Biblical leadership, hands down. You can't match it. Because it teaches you to be gracious to other people. It teaches you to be humble. It teaches you to, as I'm going to share here later, Jesus said, I came to serve. I didn't come to be served. If you look at all my, they try to tape me a lot of times around here, right, on them video things, man. And every time I say, man, you know what? I'm just here to serve, man. It's totally different than what I thought leadership was. I thought leadership, man, was when I got to a certain level, hey, bring me my coffee. You know, take my shoes down there and get them shined up, man, and bring them back to me and put them by my rack. That's what it was in the service, you know, just go take care of that for me and come back and let me know when it's done. You know, but when you come here, you know, It's almost like judo. You know what I'm saying? You get knocked off of your high horse in a heartbeat, man. You forget about trying to beat up on somebody because you're going to get towed down up in here. I'm excuse me for the camera. Street language there. But excuse me. Yeah, for real, man. So it's totally different, man. You have to kind of, you know, if you're learning anything, learn how to stay in your lane, you know. Don't try to get outside of something you don't know how to do. Well, just stay where you are. I told a guy the other day, man, brick by brick. Don't try to do too much. Brick by brick, man. It'll work out fine, you know. Don't try to do too much. And so Acts 21:13 says, so Paul, we find here, is all in, man. And it says here in 13, it says, the Lord will be done, Paul says. But he said, why all this weeping after all that they had tried to persuade him? You are breaking my heart. I'm ready not only to be jailed at Jerusalem, but even to die for the sake of the Lord Jesus. And when it was clear that we couldn't persuade him, we gave up and said, the Lord's will be done. See, they couldn't persuade Paul from doing anything else. Paul had already made up his mind a long time ago what he was going to do. And the thing that I was thinking about as I was going to the restroom before I came in here was, man, you know, anything that you do in your life, if you can go gung-ho going the wrong way, you can go gung-ho going the right way. It's a matter of choice. A lady at my job was talking earlier about might edit that for the tape. Homosexuality, man, you know, her brother. Some guy, I guess, killed some boyfriend or some whatever it was. And they were sitting around talking about scientific reason for being gay, you know, 97%. I was like, okay, it's going a little bit too far. So I said, hold on for a minute. I said, I got something I want you to read. They said, what? I said, go to Romans book, chapter 1, verse 20. I said, just read that. And they stopped and they read it. I said, see, God allows you to make a decision. The same way with people who decide to do that. You can make a decision to go right or to go wrong. All of us can. It's in our hearts to do what's right, but we choose to do something wrong. I mean, you got a whole bunch of examples of that, right? The first one being Cain and Abel. They had the same opportunity, each of them. But one of them decided to do one thing, one of them decided to do another. That's just human nature. You know, we're not all alike. But anyway, so they read that, and I said, you know, you can have peace in that. You don't have to wonder what happened to your brother, you know. I said, you don't have to wonder about that. Look, read this. It'll tell you. He made up his own mind to do what he wanted to do. Go to bed tonight and go to sleep. Period. You know? Yeah, you're right. I said, because when I try to figure it out, I get confused. I said, but God's word is clear, and I'm going to stick with that. I don't know nothing else. So I don't know about no science. I'm not a scientist. I don't know about bad family, whatever, you know. I don't know. I don't know what that does. I mean, you know, it could be possible. I don't know. But I don't know. I don't know who that is. But anyway, yeah, read that book. Best book you ever pick up in your life, man. All right. So, point being, gentlemen, is that my conclusion is that we should always be others-centered. Sharing the gospel is others-centered, right? Because think of how much you have to put yourself out there. I mean, some of us have to put ourselves really out there, like me, right? So, as I came to that, Psalm 71:17 says, oh God, you have taught me from my earliest childhood, and I constantly tell others about the wonderful things you do. I remember being in Sunday school or in church with my grandmother, man. You know, and just maybe they say she had a drug problem. She drugged me to church. You know, but from my earliest childhood, and I constantly tell others about the wonderful things that you do. God has always been good to me. I have gone all kinds of places and done all kinds of crazy things, but God has always protected me. Man, I've wrecked cars, turned them over, the whole nine yards. But I come out with glass in my elbows, man. You know what I mean? Been all over different countries and done all kinds of crazy stuff, man. But I'm standing here right now by the grace of God, man. For real, I'm telling you. So you got to tell people about what God has done for you, how far he has brought you. You know what I mean? And what he has told you about your future. I know he tells you. In Sunday school, we talk to the kids about vision. Man, I'll tell you something. You know, God speaks to us through dreams and visions, man. He can tell you. You pray. I told the kids on Sunday, I said, man, you pray before you go to bed at night. Ask your mom to read that Bible to you. When you go to sleep at night, God will give you something. He'll give you something. You wake up the next morning, man, you can tell your mama something. That's what I say. That's what God does to me. When I read the word at night, I wake up in the morning, I got something fresh. I got a whole new day ahead of me. You know, I can just think about God all day. Pastor Dave said last week, put God first. Put God first, man. If you don't put God first, you'll be working at life. That's how my life has been feeling for the last 6 months, because I put everything in front of God, man. This is a testimony. I'm telling you. You put everything in front of him, you'll be working at life. You'll be so busy, you don't even know where the time has gone. That's the truth. I'm telling you, man, put God first, man. All this other stuff, man, it'll come to you. Others centered, man, Psalms 106 and 3. There is joy for those who deal justly with others and always do what is right. Now tell me, when you're doing right by other folks, don't your day go well? Mine does. I don't know about anybody else. When I'm dealing justly with other people, I don't have to worry about you coming back saying, hey, you cheated me. You lied to me. You did this. You did that. No. I didn't say that about you. I didn't cheat you out of no money. That's what Paul's saying. I worked. We're gonna go down here. Paul said, I worked. My hands, man, I worked. You didn't have to give me anything. I didn't cheat you out of nothing. I worked for everything that I got. Right alongside of you. The same thing we should do. Deal justly with others, man. And always do what is right. Proverbs 11:25, the generous will prosper. The generous will prosper. The generous will prosper. There are a lot of folks in this church that have a need. Be generous. Try to be generous. If you don't have nothing, be genuine. If you can't be genuine, be loving. But always find somehow, man, to be generous. Whatever you have, just be generous. Give it away, man. It doesn't do you any good to hoard it. It really doesn't, man. I'm a little older now. I can say these kinds of things, you know. But when I was young, I was probably the opposite of this, man. I was selfish. I was reckless the whole nine yards, you know. So now that I'm older, I can kind of say, you know, be generous, man. It's beneficial for you, right? It says, be generous. The generous will be prosperous. Those who refresh others will themselves be refreshed. Again, you know, doing right by somebody else refreshes you. You're just going to refresh yourself, man. Be generous to other people. In Matthew 20 and 28, again, here we go. The verse, man, you don't know it, write it down. For even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve others, and to give his life as a ransom for many. Bottom line, that's all it is. If you're a follower of Christ, or he's doing something in your life right now, your example of how to be a servant of other people is to be like Jesus. Give your life as a ransom for many. If you don't have many, one. Just give it away. Is it a hard thing to do? Yeah, it is. But is it impossible? It's not impossible. God said it's not impossible. You can do it. It might take some work. It's going to take some work. You know, everybody wants. I got a little. I had to confess. My wife had knee surgery. It'll just take. And man, she had knee surgery back in. Listen, let me tell y'all something. What's said in this room stays in this room. This man's room. This ain't general population. It's man's room. So my wife had knee surgery, man, right? And back in May. And so had a little rough time, man. But point being, I got me a little man cave, right? She done commandeered my man cave. You know what I'm saying? Can y'all feel my pain? Okay. That's all I'm saying. Gotta be generous, man. You gotta come to serve. So, hey, if you can give up your man cave, that's saying something. You know what I'm saying? So, that's all I was gonna say. When you see my wife, just laugh, you know. Hey, get out of James' room. Get out of James' room. That's all. I love her to death, man. Just get out of my room. So Acts 20 and 28, man. So again, we read this earlier. So guard yourselves and God's people. Feed and shepherd God's flock, his church, purchased with his own blood, over which the Holy Spirit has appointed you as elders. I know that false teachers, Paul goes on to say that if we don't do this, man, then false teachers are going to come in. They're going to destroy the flock. They're going to come and get them. They're going to come take them. Same thing with your family. If you don't protect your family, the enemy's just waiting. He's waiting for you to step off. He's going to come get them. Hey, you got to listen to me, the word. You keep reading it, it'll tell you that. Right? So, it's important, man, as men, that we, again, like the first slide, to be committed. Right? Be committed. Got any more of these? Let's go back. Be committed. I was talking to a guy Saturday in SOD, and I probably had to go back and repent and tell this guy I was still a bit wrong. But he was talking about serving, right? And we were talking about the having to serve so much, basically, right? We all know how that is, right? And you know, I said, well, you know, man, I said, if you feel like, you know, you've been stretched that thin, you know, then, you know, like one of the leaders here told me, hey, no is a complete sentence. No is a complete sentence. Just stop. And then he says the classic answer, I feel like I got to do everything. I said, well, all of us do. You know, we all do. We all feel obligated. We all feel committed. We all honor God. We all we have courage. We all want to set the good example. We all want to serve. We all want to know that we're doing what God asks us to do. Let me tell you something. God knows. He knows how much you're serving. He knows. And he knows when you're tired. It's 24 hours in the day. 8 days of work, eight hours of work, 8 hours of rest, if you can, right? And then 8 hours of serving, if you can serve. I mean, you know. But then you have a family, if you have a family, your wife and your children need time too, right? Your house might need painted, your grass might need cut. So you can't neglect your family, right? So you have to have some sort of balance. So I guess if I had to tell it to him again, that's how I would tell it to him. You have to have some sort of balance, huh? Is he here? How you know I'm talking about? That's why I didn't mention your name. I was trying to leave you out of it. You just jumped in it anyway. That's all good, though. Yeah. So, you know, when I was, you know, so I kind of said, man, you know, you kind of have to compartmentalize those things, man. You know, not that you don't serve, not that you just say, forget serving, because like I heard today, or heard earlier today, it says, you know, it's one thing to say you need family time, right? You got to go home and take care of your family. It's another thing to go home and say, I got to take care of my family, then get in front of the TV with your family. Two different things. So that's, if I had to do it again, that's the delineation or the line that I would divide, you know, because if you just go home, put your feet up on the couch and veg out, you know, and do nothing, then yeah, you probably could be serving, you know. You could be serving. I'm guilty. I ain't better than nobody else. And that's what I'm saying. You know, I would, if I had to repeat myself, that's how I would repeat it, just that way. So, again, gentlemen, commitment, honor, courage, good example, service, and duty. These are all the examples that we want to exemplify as we walk with Christ. We want to always be in service, you know. Serve others, man. Be other-centered. How much time we got? All right. 51. Cool. Good. So, in summary, again, honor, courage, commitment. These are actually the Navy honor, courage, commitment. Three things for the Navy. So, cool. But anyway, anybody have any questions so far? Hope I didn't confuse anybody what I was talking about. But I'm blessed that you guys allowed me to come up here and speak, man. Share with you guys. Hope I didn't bore you too bad. And again, sorry for being late. So with that, we'll go ahead and pray, yeah? Got anything, Pastor Nick?
No, I think it's good.
Sweet. Praise the Lord. Yeah. All right, so let's pray. Anybody got any special prayer requests? Miles Bennett. He's doing all right. All right. Thanks so much. Dear Lord Jesus, thank you again for this wonderful evening, Father, for allowing us to come here and just speak of you, God, and give you all the praise and glory. God, we know that you are awesome. You are powerful. And there's nothing that we can do that you don't make us sufficient to do. And so, God, we thank you for that. We thank you for the bridge, God, that we can come here and just share the word openly without any fear or threat. God, we thank you for that. But God, also, we ask you to just protect those who do have that fear of threat to share your word. God, we ask you to protect all of the missionaries that are out in the field, God, that are sharing your gospel. We ask for the peace of Jerusalem. We know that won't happen until you come. And so, God, I thank you for these men that are here tonight. God, I ask you to bless Mike's wife, her foot, Father, who broke it. We know that you can bring her back up to speed very quickly. And so, God, we ask also that for she can have some rest, if it needs some rest, with a broken foot, too. Give her an opportunity to do that, God, and help her not to feel like she needs to get up too fast, because we know that that can also be damaging. So give her that time, Father. Give her that peace in her heart and in her mind, dear God, to be able to do that. We ask for a blessing upon all these men's families tonight, dear Father. Kids growing up and getting big and doing teenage things. Whew, it can be a lot on these men, dear God. But I ask you just get them a peace of mind, Father. Help them to keep their mind focused on you. Yeah. Keep their minds focused on you. And give them that drive and that commitment, God, to stay focused and to follow you and to serve and to be a blessing to others wherever they go, and to be enforcers of God, and to protect the flock. So we ask these things in your precious name. Jesus, everybody said, amen.